I've been growing vegetables in the family-sized polytunnel garden for 8 seasons now, and in the process I've added a lot of compost and other sources of fertility to the soil. I've also harvested a lot of vegetables, and with every harvest I'm extracting fertility and nutrients from the soil. In an ideal world, the amount of compost that I add would be able to provide enough fertility for the plants, in addition to what they're able to extract from the soil, but that's not always the case. And the soil didn't necessarily have good levels of balanced fertility to begin with. Since I started this garden, I've collected a number of soil samples, which I sent off to a lab for detailed analysis of a wide range of major nutrients and trace elements. And it is interesting to see how the nutritional profile of the soil has changed over the years. I first dug over the pasture to establish this polytunnel garden in 2011, and I took the first soil test of March of that year. The results showed a pH of 7.5, which is considered to be at the high end of the acceptable range for growing vegetables, but that was to be expected as we have a limestone bedrock in this region. According to the recommendations from the lab, the levels of calcium were high, the magnesium was pretty much on target, as well as the sodium, and the levels of potassium were quite low. I really didn't have a sense of what to make of the results for phosphorus or for sulfur, as well as for the trace elements, including boron, copper, and zinc. But I was glad that there was a reasonable amount of organic matter present, which is a good start. It had been a very busy season with scarce resources and no spare compost, so I decided to rely on the release of fertility from the decomposing grasses and other vegetation for the first season of growing at least. I did a second soil test the following spring, and this time I was in a better position to act on the results. The levels of calcium had increased, although interestingly the pH hadn't, and there had been a drop in the phosphorus, magnesium, sodium, and copper, with potassium and the rest of the elements broadly remaining the same or increasing a little bit. Based on these results, the soil was further out of balance, no doubt due in part to my failure to add any fertility to replace what had been extracted from the soil by the vegetables that were harvested. I attempted to do my first analysis and remineralization based on this test, following the advice of Steve Solomon and others that I had gleaned from an email discussion forum, and I tried to determine what the recommended levels for each element would be and how it compared to what was found in the soil sample. Having worked through the math, I found that the available levels of sulfur, phosphorus, copper, and zinc were all really low, between about 20 and 35% of what was desired. The levels of potassium and magnesium were also low, but not as bad, and sodium, boron, and manganese levels were fine or within 10% of the target levels. Calcium was high, of course, which is an issue that is going to be tough to deal with, and the iron was higher than target, but apparently that's okay. I then made additional calculations to figure out how to remineralize the soil or to shift the levels of each of these elements closer to the desired balance based on adding specific quantities of fertilizers and other materials that I had available or could get easily. I spread a fair amount of a mix of fertilizers to boost the phosphorus, magnesium, and potassium levels, as well as adding some nitrogen and more calcium in the process. I also spread a moderate amount of wood ash and seaweed or kelp meal to boost the potassium and sodium levels, in addition to adding a wide range of other trace elements and stuff that is really good for the soil. I then added refined chemicals to specifically boost the levels of sulfur, zinc, and copper, but only in really small amounts due to the potential toxicity of these materials, and I can always add more in following years. In the spring of 2013, I did another soil test, and Steve Solomon and Eric Reinheimer had just published a new book from which I was able to get a much better understanding about the processes and the specifics of this kind of remineralization. But most importantly, I learned that because of the calcareous soils that I was dealing with, I needed to get a different type of soil test, one that used a solvent with a higher pH. They also recommended that I used a different worksheet to determine the desired levels or balance of each of the elements within this type of soil, as they believed it was a waste of effort trying to reduce the levels of calcium, claiming that good vegetables can be grown in this type of soil with high calcium levels and a high pH, so long as all the other elements are balanced appropriately. Based on this new analysis of the recent soil test, I found that although the levels of calcium had increased a lot and the levels of magnesium and sodium had decreased, the four main cations were now in a reasonable range or balance. Levels of phosphorus and copper had increased, though not enough, and the levels of sulfur and zinc had dropped a bit, and there was a significantly less boron to be found in the soil. On the basis of this analysis, I added more concentrated refined chemicals to boost the levels of boron, copper, and zinc, as well as some gypsum, which is recommended as a better amendment for increasing levels of sulfur in calcareous soils like this. I also began a routine of adding seaweed meal and a fertilizer which was high in phosphorus, in addition to a healthy layer of compost, to each of the beds once a year and often before each crop. The following season, I started to also spread some chicken manure pellets in with the compost, seaweed, and phosphorus. And this has been my basic fertility strategy for this covered garden ever since. I felt that since the main cations were broadly within the recommended range, I would focus on feeding the soil biology and the plants, and slowly boost the phosphorus, sodium, and trace element levels in the process. I did another soil test in 2015, but unfortunately it was a standard test, so I didn't feel that I could use it as a basis for further balancing the cations. But compared to the previous tests, things seemed to be improving. The levels of calcium had dropped significantly, and I wondered to what extent this was due to the gypsum that I had added. The amount of phosphorus that was found to be available had definitely increased and was now well within the desired range, but I decided to continue to regularly add small amounts of high phosphorus fertilizer, as it seems that phosphorus availability can be temperamental in a calcareous soil with its associated high pH. Earlier this season, I finally did another soil test, both the standard test and the test that's more appropriate for this calcareous soil, and I was able to do a full comparison with the test that I did 5 years ago. The balance between calcium, magnesium, potassium, and sodium were broadly similar, with the proportions of magnesium increasing a slight bit and sodium a bit more. The amount of phosphorus was now well above the target levels. The consistent adding of a high phosphorus fertilizer had definitely paid off, and I could stop adding this amendment for the time being. The levels of all of the trace elements had increased from 2013 to the test in 2015 and have increased again in the past 3 years. The levels of sulfur, on the other hand, increased from 2013 to 2015, but have dropped again to a level comparable to the 2012 test. And I imagine that the effect of the gypsum has worn off, and it might be something that I need to look at adding a bit of each year. The levels of potassium and of boron were still a bit low according to the worksheet provided by Steve and Erica, but everything else seemed to be on target or above, which is a really nice place to be. The levels of calcium determined by the high pH test remained almost dead even over the 5 years between the two tests. But looking at the standard test, the levels of calcium had shot up to a level higher than I had seen before, and the levels of all the other major cations that were found by the standard test were also much higher. I'm not sure what's going on here, but it would explain the significant increase in the pH, and is definitely something I need to keep an eye on. I decided to test the soil again in November after the main growing season had ended, and I was quite surprised by the shift in the results in the 6 months since the previous test. The levels of calcium seem to have dropped quite significantly, while the levels of magnesium and potassium have increased quite a bit, and the levels of sulfur have increased to a level I haven't seen before. This has changed the balance of the main cations to something closer to what you might find in a non-calcareous soil. But although the pH is lower than it was 6 months ago, it is still a bit higher than it has been historically. There seems to have been a significant shift in the nature of the soil, but I haven't really changed how I'm managing it, so I can only really think that it is something due to the time of year that the soil tests were taken. This may also have been impacted by water stress issues or some other factor, but I have so little information to go on here. But I also have to remember that soil testing is just a snapshot of the soil profile at a particular time, based on a number of samples that I've taken from all the beds in the garden, and perhaps I wasn't thorough enough. Stepping back and looking at the longer trends over the last 8 years, the levels of calcium have fluctuated quite a bit, which could be due to variations due to the growing season or some other factor. The interplay between the levels of sulfur and calcium, with one going up while the other goes down, may be directly linked, and it would be interesting to see if this continues in the coming seasons. The levels of most of the other nutrients follow the same general path of dropping in the first few years and then increasing. This makes sense given the history of the garden, which was initially converted from fallow ground, then had a few harvests without adding anything to the soil, and then the gradual buildup and balancing of the soil fertility as I took more responsibility in amending and feeding the soil. The levels of potassium and zinc have also increased over time, although they didn't see an initial drop. The percentage of organic matter has also gradually increased, which is great, especially in the heat of the polytunnel, except for a dip in the past 6 months, which could be because I haven't topped up the compost yet. Based on the last two tests, I wouldn't be concerned about needing to remineralize anything, and I can shift to a different strategy of maintaining the fertility balance and levels, which is essentially adding the nutrients that would be used by the crops, mostly by continuing to add compost. Over time, I hope that the percentage of organic matter will continue to increase, as well as the availability of overall fertility in the soil. But I plan to keep taking soil tests so that I can continue to balance the levels between all the various nutrients in the soil. I plan to do another soil test in March once the soil warms up and the soil biology becomes much more active. And it would be really interesting to do an additional test in the summer and at the end of the season to see if the strange shift in the available nutrients is repeated. There is so much to learn about all of this, but I'm quite pleased with the recent test results and more importantly with how well the plants in this garden have been growing in general. Looking back over the years, I wish I had done more testing and amending sooner, but even if it took me an extra couple of years, I'm quite pleased with how I've managed the soil in this garden up until this point, and I hope it continues to improve.